The following voices are AI generated. We hope you enjoy the video. Hey, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to another random talk with me, Amy, and Shadow. Today, we're discussing the idea of the 2001 Mariah Carey album and movie having a video game.
That's right, Blue Hedgehog. Normally, I don't talk about that diva of a singer, but having a video game based on the ill-fated movie and album would have been an interesting idea, especially considering that every popular thing had a video game back in the 90s and early 2000s.
It wasn't until the early 2010s when licensed video games slowed down with their oversaturation. The Glitter album was not successful, but underrated, and gradually more beloved over the years, especially during its 20th anniversary. The same cannot be said about the movie.
I totally agree. The creator of the channel still refuses to review the movie because of how it's considered to be not only one of the worst movies of the early 2000s, not only the worst movie involving legit musicians, but also one of the worst movies of all time period. It's that bad.
Hell, even we won't do a full-on review of the movie. What were the Hollywood people thinking when they greenlit this film? The acting is wooden. The editing is a load of crap. Like if Sonic and I edited the high-speed parts while either high or drunk, and the writing is bare bones.
And the release date of both the movie and album was bad timing, as the tragic attacks in New York City from the bastard terrorists during September of that same year. The film bombed at the box office, and the album sold poorly. Because of all that, Mariah Carey herself distanced herself from the movie and was even hospitalized after being stressed and overworked by the film, the promotion, and its failure. She was then diagnosed with bipolar disorder afterward, which, by the way, is what the creator of this channel also has.
I gotta admit it. Glitter having a video game sounds both silly, yet ambitious. Mariah Carey in a video game is a missed opportunity, and having a new character named Lloyd Stevens, played by Chris Jericho, would have redeemed Glitter as a whole.
And having the game on every conceivable console back in 2001 would have made the game sell better than the album and movie in theaters. Mariah Carey should have done at least one song in a Sonic game. Or Chris Jericho's band Fozzy doing a song in a Shadow game sequel.
Somewhere in the multiverse, this hypothetical Glitter game is real, and Mariah Carey is a gamer while also being the same worldwide singing sensation as she is here, and a close friend of Chris Jericho. Meanwhile, in this universe, she's not much of a gamer, nor knows Jericho or anything about wrestling in general.
I'd imagine Glitter on the Sega Dreamcast have Adventure 2 Easter eggs and cameos like a billboard of me or a poster of Adventure 2 itself. How about reusing some music like the Speed Shoes and Invincibility power-ups? I'd also see Billy Frank wear soap shoes like I did. Or better yet, us as plush dolls in the background.
In that case, Sonic Adventure 2 and Glitter would have both been the swan songs of Sega's final home console in the market before it went third party. I bet Billy Frank would complimented my edginess on our billboard in New York City.
The most interesting thing about the Glitter game is the two endings. There's original movie ending where Billy stays with Dice, and the new game exclusive alternate ending where Billy chooses Lloyd. It's so romantic, right, Sonic?
Yeah, but the original movie ending is tragic, as Timothy got away with murder. But the new ending where Billy sticks with Lloyd is more uplifting, and a satisfying conclusion where Lloyd fights Timothy and Dice survives.
A love triangle was, in my opinion, the most interesting about the Glitter game. It's baffling that Lloyd Stevens isn't in the movie, because Chris Jericho was still busy wrestling and was quintessential to the WWF invasion angle.
Remind me of that disappointing storyline. Damn Vince McMahon for boosting his ego and wasting money on a failed football league instead of buying out the Time Warner contracts of the real WCW stars.
We'll talk about pro wrestling in the near future. Anyway, only AI is the closest thing to Chris Jericho and Mariah Carey doing anything together, whether it's their music, photo art, or even stories.
I heard somewhere in the multiverse that Glitter has two canceled spin-offs. A direct sequel on Nintendo 64, and a wrestling and music game starring the two stars. Also, Mariah Carey was in a couple of WWE games as a secret unlockable.
Ooh, let me see. Not only that, But Mariah Carey even was a guest character in Tony Hawk Pro Skater 4 and both Underground games in that alternate universe. That means she's in the same game as Shrek in Tony Hawk Underground 2.
For once, someone mentioned Shrek in front of me. You didn't bring up that hideous fan art of me and that ogre making out like Knuckles did. Why do people ship Shrek of all characters with me? It'd be better if it was Maria as an ogress.
That's the internet for you, Shadow. People make weird crap like that. Not to mention both Sonic and Shrek both have a random affiliation with the term all-star.
We went from talking about Mariah Carey and her glitter project and Chris Jericho's characters Lloyd Stevens to Shrek. What's next? SpongeBob?
I guess Shrek and SpongeBob were both the two most popular animated characters in the early 2000s in both movies and cartoons, while Sonic and I were the faces in video games right below Super Mario at the same time. We'll talk about the early 2000s as a whole in a future video.
Back to Glitter. Not only would it be on Sega Dreamcast, but also PlayStation 1, PlayStation 2, Nintendo 64, GameCube, the original Xbox, Game Boy Advance, Game Boy Color, and PC. That's right up there with Ratatouille as a game with the most consecutive multi-console releases.
I bet the PS1 port of Glitter would have been the first one to be made, and as the most successful one of the ports by having 8 million copies sold. And the GameCube and Xbox ports could be launch titles since the movie and album came out in 2001. And I bet the GBA port would have also been a bestseller, around 1 to 2 million copies sold.
The original Xbox and Game Boy Color ports would have been a North American exclusive, while all the other ports of Glitter would have been released worldwide. I could even see the PS1 port having a greatest hits label, and the GBA and GameCube ports having a player's choice label as well.
Activision would have been the publisher of the game, while Sony Computer Entertainment would have published the PS1 and 2 ports, while both Activision and Sega published the Dreamcast ports together. That way, Sonic Adventure 2 can be implemented in the game, with Easter eggs of the characters and added music and the soap shoes.
The addition of game-exclusive character Lloyd Stevens would have made the game much better than the movie if the game was real, and if Chris Jericho himself took a break from wrestling, and if the writers squeezed Lloyd Stevens to the movie's script and make the movie more bearable, then it'd be improved and less awful.
I absolutely agree tenfold, Sonic. A rock star and pro wrestler in a movie about a talented dancer who becomes a singing sensation would have sounded more interesting than a bare-bones toxic love story with a music career thrown in. Dice was a control freak, and I think a love triangle would spice things up, like how I think about Rouge and Maria in my dreams.
And having Billy Frank choosing Lloyd Stevens over Dice would have been a better ending, and we'd see a rare clash of two genres. Mariah Carey sings R&B, and Chris Jericho singing hard rock. We'd hear a soulful rock ballad at the end of the movie and game, where Billy and Lloyd sing a powerful love ballad together and get married. Billy reunites with her mother and shows Lloyd to her, and Billy and Lloyd get married, have lots of babies, and live happily ever after. That's how Glitter should have ended.
One more new major plot point before we discuss the gameplay. In the intro, where Billy was a young girl watching her mom performing at a bar, also has Lloyd as a young boy who has a rock star mom. Basically, Billy and Lloyd have more in common than we think. They both got musician mothers, but in different genres.
The console gameplay is your typical 3D action-adventure platformer. There's also puzzles and collectibles mostly related to music, like sheet music, microphones, portable DJ systems, and CDs. The handheld ports are side-scrollers, similar to Super Mario Brothers.
Just like most movie-based games at the time, scenes from the film are shown in between levels, except for the Nintendo 64 port due to its limitations. Also, all of the songs from the album are in the game. Even 8-bit renditions of the songs are in the Game Boy Color port.
The first few levels of the console ports have tutorials for Billy with her foster friends Roxanne and Louise, being the ones who help the player with the game and its mechanics. Since these are the early levels, they're bound to be easy and quick. As the levels progress, they get more difficult, especially with the two endings.
For health and power-ups, Billy has food and first aid kits for health and big red hearts as extra lives. The food ranges from burgers, hot dogs, soda, French fries, apples, donuts, soft pretzels and pizza, to salads. pizza and first aid kits gain 100% health, while apples and hot dogs gain the least health at around 15 to 25%. My personal favorite is pizza, specifically cheese.
Billy's attacks are quite interesting. She starts with slapping and kicking, but as the game progresses, she uses her powerful voice to stun enemies, a noisy microphone whine, a slingshot, and a water squirter gun. The powerful voice then gets an upgrade called the Honey Voice, as a reference to Mariah Carey's hit song Honey. And the water squirter gun also gets an upgrade, and it's a BB gun that knocks down enemies.
Speaking of enemies, they're all over the game. There are masked burglars, creepy stalkers, paparazzi, pecking birds, angry girl singers who can't sing, and even female muggers. The male enemies make the same funny stock sound effects as the enemies in the N64 GoldenEye game, the Pamela Anderson show VIP for PS1, and even the early demo of the Jet Li PS2 game Rise to Honor. The female enemies make original noises, screams, and grunts when they're attacked.
In addition to regular puzzle platform levels, where you go from point A to point B, there are different kinds of levels, like a time limit level, where you need to go as fast as possible to the end, like when Sonic and I had to leave Prison Island in Sonic Adventure 2. Then there are rival levels, where you get challenged by another character in a singing battle. Next is a chase level, where Billy and Lloyd are being chased by a big, disgusting pro wrestler. And lastly, a stealth level, where Billy hides from Timothy. This particular level takes place when the player chooses Billy to be with Dice, like in the movie.
And the best part of the game is what I already explained earlier. The alternate ending where Billy goes with Lloyd instead of Dice. And the alternate final level is called What If? This is where you play as another character for the only time in the game, as Lloyd fighting Timothy on behalf of Billy and Dice, and it's the only boss battle. If this was real, Mariah Carey probably would have collaborated with Mr. Y2J in WWE in the past, or even AEW today.
It's weird that the creator of this channel is probably the only person in the world who is a fan of both Chris Jericho and Mariah Carey, since they both do different genres of music, and Carey hasn't done anything involving pro wrestling like Jericho.
That's why the multiverse exists, Sonic. I bet there's more shadow games in the multiverse too. I can already imagine Mariah Carey trying out metal or hard rock, or Chris Jericho branching out to do more pop or R&B or even hip hop. Better yet, Mariah Carey even being a guest star in either WWE or AEW, whether as a member of the audience, a valet for Jericho, or even wrestling herself, which is too late now.
And if Glitter was a better movie, and if the album itself sold better, Carey would have continued doing more movies, and her hiatus from music between the Charm Bracelet album and Emancipation of Mimi album wouldn't have happened, and we would have had two more albums in 2003 and 2004. And if Jericho was in the movie for real, they definitely would have done songs together, and maybe Carey would have been in WWE along with Jericho or in AEW. The possibilities are endless, and the multiverse is full of interesting alternative scenarios.
Back to the game, there are unlockables you unlock after progressing each level, especially after collecting the items. If you collect all CDs and DJ systems, you unlock storyboards. Depending on the amount of collectibles, they're even unlockable multiplayer mini-games.
Collecting sheet music, microphones, and music notes unlocks the multiplayer mini-games and Mariah Carey songs. With the exception of the N64 version, there are special golden CDs that unlock cutscenes from the movie, and even trailers for the movie, commercials for the album, and behind the scenes of the game.
For the Game Boy Color and Advance ports, the collectibles are more limited, but the puzzle solving is a lot more involved compared to the console and PC ports of Glitter. Not only that, but the supercharged jump reminds me of the American and European version of Super Mario Bros. 2. You know, the one that introduced Birdo and Wart, as well as Peach and Toad, as playable characters. Too bad Billy is the only one playable in the handheld ports. Not even Lloyd appears, or even gets mentioned in the handheld ports.
The story of the handheld ports are completely different from the console and PC versions. Billy is an average woman who's a very talented singer who needs to do errands and wants to collect enough items to prepare for a singing gig at a bar to impress a music producer for a record deal. It's that simple of a story, with no romance like in the movie.
The Game Boy Color is known for its delayed controls and outdated NES graphics, but I thought it looked better than the N64 port. I thought the N64 port of Glitter was supposed to be a superior PS1 port, but on a cartridge. But no, Billy looks like a potato, and the music is bit crushed and lower quality, like the wrestlers' theme songs in WWF No Mercy, which was also on the Nintendo 64.
The PS1 port has a blend of realism and that Bratz-style design, and Billy looks like a slender, scantily clad model, while in the N64 port, she looks like she gained weight. BTW, no offense to Mariah Carey or anyone who's sensitive with their weight. The Dreamcast port is identical to the PS1, but with less pixels. As for the PS2, Xbox, GameCube, and PC ports, the graphics are enhanced and even more stunning. It's like a sparkly, uncanny blend of anime and realism.
So, the multiplayer minigames have a decent bit of variety. There's musical chairs, a DDR-style minigame called Kick It, bowling, rock and roll, Simon Says, a foot race, and much more. My favorite is the foot race since it reminds me of Sonic R, even though we weren't in that game. The classic characters were there.
The GBA and Game Boy Color ports also have the mini games, but they're limited. They also got Kick It and bowling, but they each got an exclusive mini game. The Game Boy Color port has golf, and the GBA port has a mini game that has a toy car race. What's cool about the handheld ports with their mini-games is that they each use their link cables so players can play together with two Game Boys and two copies of Glitter.
And I guess the multiplayer mode using the link cable somehow made Glitter on Game Boy Advance sell better because of it. Maybe it was also because of the alternate cover art of the player's choice copy. That's what I saw in the multiverse. I sure love the toy car race minigame as it's simple, cute, and intuitive.
Speaking of cover art, the 6th-gen ports of Glitter use the album's pink cover art, with the exception of the Xbox port, which has a green hue to be consistent with its then-new library. The 5th-gen ports use the VHS and DVD blue cover art, with the exception of the N64 port, which uses an image of Billy laying down and another cover art. Of a close-up of the pink cover art, and that N64 port is the one where Glitter on Nintendo 64 is called Glitter 64. Since this was late 2001, Glitter 64 would have been the final video game on N64 to incorporate the gimmick of having 64 in a game's title.
And even though the Sega Dreamcast was a 6th-gen console, the Dreamcast port of Glitter used the blue cover art like the PS1 and Game Boy Color. Just like we said before, Sega and Activision co-published Glitter on Dreamcast and had Sonic Adventure 2, Easter eggs, and cameos. I think it would have been a stellar port, even though people would have preferred the PlayStation 1 and 2 ports, as well as the GameCube port.
We also forgot to mention the developers of the game. It was developed by two British studios, Eurocom Entertainment Software and Traveler's Tales. The handheld ports were both developed by Vicarious Visions, with Sony publishing both PlayStation ports and Activision publishing the other ports. The game definitely would have had a lot of marketing, like showing it off in E3 or making commercials around the world, and of course, advertising the game into the album and vice versa.
I can already imagine the same gamers being hyped for the GameCube and Xbox being announced, as well as the announcement of Super Smash Bros. Melee. But then we hear Mariah Carey vocalizing off-screen, and we hear her sing one of the Glitter songs to surprise the geeks and nerds. No offense. Then, after Carey ended her song, we see the developers and people in charge of the game showing footage. It would either be exciting or cringe-inducing, depending on what you think.
Honestly, I'd imagine the commercials being different by region. Europe and Australia could simply show the gameplay and a narrator in different languages. Meanwhile, in Japan, we see a remake the commercials of Sonic Adventure 1, but with Billy Frank as a plush doll instead of Sonic, Tails, Knuckles, and Big the Cat. Meanwhile, North America gets the most commercials, like a woman who can't sing, then holds a copy of Glitter the Game and suddenly sings like a pro.
The Xbox port could have its own commercial like a tease of Halo, but then we see it's just Billy Frank removing Master Chief's helmet as a way to hype both Halo and Glitter as Xbox launch titles. My favorite commercials are for the handheld ports. One spoofs the WWF SmackDown games on PS1, but it's Chris Jericho instead of The Rock and Kurt Angle, and he gets Glitter as a hotel room key and enjoys the game. The other is just Chris Jericho and Mariah Carey dating at a bar playing dress-up, and we even get a cameo from Movie Sonic's actor at the end.
Playing dress-up at the bar would have been funny, as they could have dressed as different musicians of all decades and genres, and people would have cheered for them. Movie Sonic's actor could have said this to end the commercial.
No fair. I wish I could change like that. I'll have what they're having.
But for the rest of the port's commercials in North America, the plush adventure of Billy Frank could have been used. Not just in Japan, but in America too. We'd see Billy as a plush doing outrageous things, like rock climbing, hiking in snow mountains, jumping on the moon, boxing, skydiving, or even swinging on vines. Then, as the commercial ends, we find out it was all in a little girl's imagination, as she was just playing with the Billy Frank plush doll. And that little girl has an uncanny resemblance to Billy Frank herself.
Of course we can all agree that Glitter would have gotten a digital re-release on Steam. Before Eurocom's closure in 2012, Glitter was remastered and added all the Sonic Adventure 2 content and other third-party Easter egg cameos like Spyro, Crash Bandicoot, and Tekken in the Steam release. And it became a monster hit as it was downloaded 90 million times. Wow. I guess somewhere in an alternate timeline, Glitter was that good and it got remastered. I thought the PS1 port of Glitter was the most successful version, but no. The Steam port was the true ultimate deluxe way to play the Glitter game.
Not only that, Glitter on Steam would have also had graphical enhancements, like the character models resembling PS3 or Xbox 360 models, since it was 2012.
Yeah, and the only modern game console to possibly play Glitter is the Xbox Series X and S, since the Steam is PC. And because Microsoft owns Xbox, it's fitting to have the remastered port Glitter exclusively on PC, and later, Xbox consoles. How odd, since the original Xbox and PC port of Glitter didn't have any Easter eggs or cameos, since the original Xbox was the very first Microsoft game console. And it didn't have established franchises besides Halo, since it was literally new. The PC port, on the other hand, didn't have any Easter eggs or franchise cameos for no reason.
Oh my god, shut the hell up about Glitter already. It's bad enough that you three had to run your mouths on that crappy film, but then you talk about a game that doesn't even exist based on that movie. Then you bring up that wrestler rock star who's probably not wanting to do anything with that diva singer.
Great. Dreamcast Sonic is here. What are you doing here, Grumpy?
We were just having fun with all the what-if scenarios. And I guess you are one of those people who happens to be too serious to be in this chat. I know technically it would have been you in the Glitter game instead of me, since it would have came out in 2001.
And I guess you're not a Mariah Carey or Chris Jericho fan.
They're both overrated. Mariah Carey is a selfish lady who clearly wasn't meant to act, and I'm glad she's not in many movies. As for that Jericho, he's also too arrogant. He's done too many things at once. It makes me sick. I wish they could just retire already.
Whoa there. Jesus, Sonic. You're clearly gonna get a lot of hate from two fan bases. You do realize that the Glitter game is real in the multiverse. It's not real in this world, but it is in alternate dimensions.
Exactly! I think you're just jealous that Jericho and Carey are doing a lot better than you have, and you haven't really done anything after Advance 3 and Heroes besides that audiobook-like story with Tails!
Even though the four kids era characters are replaced, at least we still have fun living our lives and discussing things. With you, we're basically brothers that argue a lot, along with movie Sonic and current slash meta era Sonic.
I get what you mean. We were all replaced. And yes, I am deep down jealous of the successes of Chris Jericho and Mariah Carey. I've been doing a lot of research, and they've been doing a lot more songs lately. And yes, I'm basically the grumpy older Sonic brother when you think about it. Honestly, if I was in the Glitter game, whether as a billboard or even a plush doll, I bet people would love to see me more involved. The multiverse is interesting too, even though I blame superhero movies for exploiting the concept of the multiverse.
That's a very very good point. I bet someday people would probably groan at some IP or franchise muddle in a multiverse story or some bullcrap. I guess that wraps up our skit about glitter today, ladies and gentlemen.
We had a lot of fun discussing the game until Dreamcast Sonic showed up. But don't worry, we got more subjects to talk about in the near future.
What else can we talk about next, and who can we invite? Let us know in the comments down below.
Don't forget to click the bell so you won't miss any of our videos. Give us a like, favorite, subscribe, and share. Peace out, and rock on.